Hi guys, welcome back to NextOps channel. In the previous video, we discussed about VNet options as part of implementing and managing Azure virtual networks and stopped at network security groups. So in this video, we will learn about network security groups. If you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, please go ahead and do it now to receive the new video updates via notifications. And do not forget to click on the bell icon. Before we move on to technical discussion, a little bit about myself. If you want to reach out to me, please contact me through my blog or send me a connection request on LinkedIn or leave a comment on my YouTube channel. If you want to find my videos on YouTube the easy way, then use the keywords displayed here. And one last thing, if you haven't watched previous videos about VNet creation and VNet options, please go ahead and watch them before watching this video, as it makes more sense if you do so. We were discussing about subnets in the previous video and stopped at network security groups. This is one of my favorite topics. Let me explain in detail. What are network security groups? A network security group contains security rules that allow or deny inbound traffic to or outbound traffic from several types of Azure resources. An Azure resource can be a virtual machine, a web app, or a database. You can filter network traffic to and from Azure resources in a VNet with a network security group. That's what its basic functionality is. As you can see from the diagram below, you can associate an NSG to a subnet within a VNet or to a network interface card within a subnet. Before creating our first network security group, let us know a few important points about NSGs. Network security groups' security rules are evaluated by priority using the phi tuple information to allow or deny the traffic. Phi tuple information is nothing but source port, destination port, and protocol. We can see that when we create our rules. In an NSG, rules with lowest number have highest priority, and each rule will be evaluated based on their priority number and phi tuple information to control the traffic flow. A flow record is created for existing connections, which means a flow record is nothing but a rule here. Flow record defines the traffic flow, whether we allow or deny. Based on that, traffic will be flowed between the Azure resources. Communication is allowed or denied based on the connection state of the flow record. If we allow the traffic through the role, it will be allowed. If we deny, it will be denied. Existing connections may not be interrupted when you remove a security rule that enables the flow. What does it mean? For example, if you have a virtual machine and you have opened an RDP connection to it, someone from your team have updated the NSG rule that controls this RDP access and changed it to deny while you're using it, which actually doesn't close your existing connection. So existing connection will be preserved, will not be interrupted if someone updates the security rule that is affecting the access to your resource. Traffic flows are actually interrupted when connections are stopped and no traffic is flowing in either direction for at least few minutes. In the above case, we have opened RDP connection, so existing connection will not be terminated. When they will be terminated, when they will be interrupted, when there are no connections at all, when there is no traffic is flowing in either direction for at least few minutes. It should be idle for a few minutes. There are few other points also. The flow record allows a network security group to be stateful, which means NSG itself is stateful. So what is it meant by statefulness? If you specify an outbound security rule to any address or port ID, which means you are trying to access a website from your virtual machine within the subnet over port 80. There is no need of defining inbound security rule for the response to the outbound traffic. That is what statefulness is. So you only define outbound rule to access the website from your virtual machine. There is no need of defining the inbound rule for this. NSG itself defines the rule to allow the inbound traffic as a response from the outbound connection. That's what it is called as statefulness. And this is also applicable to inbound connections. If you're allowing some inbound traffic to your virtual machine. The response from your virtual machine is an outbound to the remote server. So the outbound rule will not be necessary to be created. This will be handled by the NSG itself because it is stateful. You only need to specify an inbound security rule if communication is initiated externally. What does it mean? For example, you have a virtual machine and you hosted a website on top of it. And that is a business-centric website. And you need to open it for your customers. People from the external networks, like internet, should be able to access the website. Otherwise, you won't do any business at all. So in such case, you need to allow inbound traffic to your virtual machine on port 80 or 443. In such cases, we need to create inbound security rules if communication is initiated externally. There are some limits on NSGs per region per subscription. We can create up to 5,000 network security groups within a region per subscription. And also, we can create up to 1,000 rules per NSG per region per subscription. That is a huge number anyway. Okay, let's take a look at the NSG rule information. As I mentioned earlier, each rule contains 5 tuple information and a unique name, priority number, traffic direction, and finally action to be taken, allow or deny. Rule name should be meaningful and descriptive to avoid confusion in the future. Priority number, rule with the lowest priority number has highest priority over the other rules. Source or destination can be an IP address or a CIDR block or a service tag or an application security group. Protocol can be TCP, UDP, ICMP or any. Direction defines the flow of your traffic, either it is inbound or outbound. Port range, on which port you want to allow the traffic. Action, whether you want to allow or deny the traffic. So this is what a typical NSG rule looks like. We need to fill all these details when we are creating a rule within the network security group. When we create a new NSG, few default rules will be automatically created by Azure, and they will have highest numbers and lowest priority starting from 65,000. Okay, let's go ahead and create one NSG in our subscription and associate with it with our public subnet that we have created in the earlier video. And then let us create a rule to allow RDP access to the subnet, which in turn applies to all the machines in that subnet. If you can remember from the previous video, we have created a virtual machine in the public subnet. So if we create an NSG and create a RDP allow rule in that NSG and associate this NSG to our subnet, the same rule will be applied to the virtual machines inside that subnet also. So after associating the NSG, we can verify the connectivity to our machine. So let me switch to my portal and create our first NSG. Before creating our first NSG, let's go ahead and verify our virtual machines and subnets. So we have created a virtual network previously in the previous video. That is NextOps VNet01. And we have created a subnet as part of deployment, that is public subnet 01. When we click on it, we don't have any NSG network security group associated to this as of now. And later, to show you the connected devices option within the VNet, I have created a virtual machine and the associated network interface card has been reflected in the connected devices section of the VNet. So we have created a virtual machine to demonstrate this. Now we have a VM ready for us. If we open the VM options and go to the networking tab, we can see the associated NSGs for this particular VM. So this VM already been associated to a NSG. If you see the name of the NSG, it is NextOps VM01-NSG. It's the same as the VM name with a NSG as the suffix. So this means it was created during the provisioning of this VM itself. We haven't explicitly created this NSG. And as part of the creation process, we have allowed RDP access to this particular virtual machine. If you go to overview of this VM, we can see the details of the VM. The VM state is running. It is located in East US and subscription, blah, blah, blah. And this particular VM has public IP address associated with it. So when I discuss about the virtual machines, I'll touch base all these options in that video. But so far, for this particular demonstration, I'll stick with this information. So I copied the public IP for this particular VM, and I've installed a tool called Remote Connection Desktop Manager, where I imported my VM. If you can see, the IP address I have given to this particular VM is same as the IP address displayed here, 114.144. If I click on connect, I should be able to open the RDP connection to this particular VM, because this VM has been associated with an NSE already, which was created during the VM provisioning, and it has a rule called allow RDP. That is the reason why we were able to connect to the machine using the public IP and logged in now. Let's go ahead and delete this rule and see if it terminates the existing connection for us. And remember, this particular NSE has been associated with the network interface card of this VM, not to the subnet. We verified the subnets a few seconds ago, and our subnet hasn't been attached to any of the NSEs because we haven't created any NSE explicitly. This was created during the VM creation process. That is the reason why it was attached to the network interface card here. And if you click on the NSE name, you can see the NSE options, where we can see whether it has been associated to any subnet or interface. Okay, let me go directly from here. And here, if we associated this NSE to any subnets, subnets will be displayed here. It says no results. So this particular NSE does not associate it to any of the subnets. If you click on network interface cards, it's been associated to our VM. All right. So we have updated the inbound security rule. We deleted the allow RDP rule. So let's verify the connectivity to the VM. It is still running. There is no interruption at all. That is what I have discussed in the slide, where the existing connections will not be interrupted when we modify the network security group rules. But if we disconnect to this VM and try to reconnect, it won't allow us, because there is no more allow RDP rule exists in the NSE associated with this VM. If we click on connect now, it won't allow us to connect back. It will throw you an error saying that the connection will not be allowed. It is taking longer than expected, so which means our NSE is blocking the access to this particular VM now. So updating NSE rules impacts instantly. So let's go back to our network security groups and create our first network security group from here. So this is what that has been associated with the VM. So let me select my resource group, and I am going to create an NSE with the name of pub subnet NSG01, because I am going to associate this with my public subnet. Click on review and create. It will validate your inputs, and once it is validated, we can create the network security group. So creating network security group doesn't take more than 1 or 2 minutes. So just bear with me, and once the deployment is completed, we can verify the options and associate this particular network security group that we created now to our public subnet and see how it is impacting the virtual machine that is part of this public subnet. We can actually see two network security groups associated to that VM now. While it is deploying, let's verify the current configuration of the VM from the networking tab, so we can see whether there is any other NSEs associated with this. So far, it's only NextOps VM-NSG has been associated. There is no other NSGs being associated to this particular VM. But once the deployment is finished, if we associate this particular newly created NSG to our public subnet, then the same will be inherited to this VM also, because this VM is part of public subnet. So this is getting created now. Just wait for one more minute and we'll continue with the configuration process. All right, the deployment of the NSG is complete now. Let's go to the resource and verify its settings. As I mentioned in the slide, these were the default groups that have been created by Azure itself automatically. I haven't touched anything. I just created the NSG. So if you can see from the screen, you can see the priority number starting from 65,000. And we can only use the priority numbers between 0 to 100 to 4096 if they are custom rules. If the rules created by us, then we can start from 100 and end with 4096. We cannot use the numbers other than those numbers. Okay, first let's go ahead and associate. First, let's go ahead and create our security rule to allow the RDP traffic to this particular subnet. To create the rule, I've clicked on inbound rules and clicked on add button here. It has opened another blade to fill up the details. As you can see, we need to fill the five tuple information, that is source port, destination port, and protocol. So source, I am giving it as any for the purpose of demonstration, because it will be allowed from the internet if it is any. And I don't want to specify any port of the source connection because it can be anything. Destination also any, because we are going to connect to our virtual machine. I don't want to make it more complicated. Otherwise, we can use IP address and specify our public IP here. But I don't want to make it more complicated. So I'm going to use any, but in the destination port range, I know the port number of RDP. So I'm using that port number here. And traffic would be TCP for RDP. And I wanted to allow the traffic. And I'm giving priority number is 100. And I'm giving the name of allow RDP subnet NSG rule. So it's a meaningful name for me, but you need to make it more meaningful when you create it. So I'm going to click on it. So this will create a rule for us for this particular NSG. This is an additional rule. There is a warning out there, which means we are allowing this connection from anywhere, right? So that is the reason Azure is showing a warning here. And then let's go ahead and associate this NSG with our public subnet. To do that, we need to go to the subnets and click on associate. From the virtual network list, we need to select our virtual network, and subnet list, we need to select our subnet and click on OK. This will associate this NSG to our subnet, and these settings and rules will be inherited by the virtual machine inside the subnet. I'm not going to associate this with any interfaces here, because we have an NSG that has been already associated to the virtual machine interface. So let's go to the virtual machine now. And look at the networking properties. Now we should see both NSGs information. So inbound port rules coming from public NSG and coming from NextOps VM specific NSG. So here both NSGs have conflict rules. One NSG is not allowing RDP access. The other one is allowing the RDP access. Which one is going to take the priority here? Let's go ahead and initiate the connectivity to the VM. If it gets allowed, then subnet's NSG is taking over the priority. If it is not getting connected, then it's a priority taken by the VM specific NSG, that is the NSG associated to the interface. I hope the connection is not getting established. That means the rules from the NextOps VM NSG is taking precedence over the rules of public subnet NSG. Now, this is a situation where we cannot identify where the problem is coming from. In this scenario, we only have a couple of rules. So we can easily identify which rule is causing the problem. But there might be a scenario situation where you will be having thousands of rules, because an NSG can hold up to 1,000 rules, right? So maybe you have associated 3 more NSGs to this particular VM, and each of the NSGs have 1,000 rules, so which will become 5,000 rules. So searching through those rules and filtering out which particular rule is conflicting and denying the connectivity is a biggest task. To resolve that this issue easily, you can go to diagnose and solve problems, where you can find, this is the best use case, where you can find cannot connect to VM problem, and using which you can select troubleshoot network security group, and immediately automated troubleshooter will kicked off by the Azure, and it will evaluate the existing NSG rules and come up with a recommended solution. To easily identify the conflicted rules, you can actually use this particular option, and correcting those rules will give you access to your virtual machine. So it will not be taking more than a minute to run the troubleshooter in most cases. So once it is done, we can see appropriate solution recommended by Microsoft, and what is the current situation of the connectivity. Everything will be evaluated, and then Microsoft will give you a specific recommendation. But in this case, troubleshooter is unable to find issues with any of the resource, so which means our resource is configured correctly, but we are unable to connect to it still. So let's go ahead and do one thing. Go to the networking tab, click on our network interface card, and dissociate this particular NSG. Which means we are removing association of NSG from the network interface card. Now our virtual machine will be having only NSG coming from the subnet associated with it. In that NSG, we have allowed RDP access, which means we should be able to connect to the virtual machines without any problem now. So now the NSG that's been associated to the interface has been removed. Only the NSG that is coming from the subnet has been associated. Let's go ahead and hit the server back through RDP, and now we are able to connect to the VM back. So this is how you can actually use the NSGs to allow or deny the traffic within your subnet or to your resources within your VNet. Okay, let's go back to our slides and discuss about next topics. They are augmented security rules and service tags. What are augmented security rules? Augmented security rules simplify security definition for virtual networks, allowing you to define larger and complex network security policies with fewer rules. You can combine multiple ports and multiple explicit IP addresses and ranges into a single, easily understood security rule. Use augmented rules in the source, destination, and port fields of a rule. To simplify maintenance of your security rule definition, combine augmented security rules with service tags or application security groups whenever possible. In our NSG, we created a rule and used any as source for our RDP connection. Here, there are other options like IP addresses or CIDR block, right? Before augmented security rules, we were only allowed to use single IP or single CIDR block. In that case, if we wanted to allow multiple IPs using the IP address as the source, then we need to create individual rules for each IP or CIDR block, which becomes more complex because we need to create multiple rules for individual IPs. With the introduction of augmented security rules, Now we can add multiple IPs or CIDR blocks in the same rule, which obviously reduces the complexity of NSG rules and also reduces the number of rules to be defined. Take a look at the below image where we have a rule with priority 1000 and destination field has multiple CIDR blocks separated by commas. This is how we can specify NSG rules with augmented security rule sets. And next we have service tags. What are service tags? A service tags represent a group of IP address prefixes from a given Azure service. It helps minimize complexity of frequent updates on network security rules. This is also like augmented security rule, but here we don't specify IPs or CIDR blocks. Instead, we select the tag, which in turn have blocks of IPs or CIDRs associated with it in the background, which are defined by the Microsoft. As you can see from the diagram, there are service tags called Internet Virtual Network, Azure Load Balancer, Service Bus, Azure Cloud, etc. So these are all services provided by Azure itself. And Azure does know what IPs are being used by these services in the background. So when we create a security rule that is pointing to a service tag as a source or destination, then indirectly we will be allowing access or denying access to that block of IP addresses or CIDR blocks, as we did in the augmented security rules. So this is all to simplify the NSG rule definitions. Instead of creating number of NSG rules with the introduction of augmented security rules and service tags, now it has been reduced to a lesser number of rules in any specific NSG. Then there is one more last topic in NSGs called effective security rules. What are effective security rules? NSGs enable you to control the types of traffic that flow in and out of a VM or subnet. When we associate the NSG with VM's interface, it will be belonging to VM, single VM itself. If it is associated with a subnet, it applies to all the VMs in that subnet. So it controls the type of traffic, how it should be flowed, and everything will be controlled. You can associate an NSG to a subnet in an Azure Virtual Network or a network interface card attached to a VM or both. Rules in different NSGs can sometimes conflict with each other and impact a VM's network connectivity. That's what we saw earlier in the effective security rules, where we have figured out which rule is causing the problem and which rule is taking precedence over interface NSG and subnets NSG. Once again, let's go back to the portal and verify these settings. When we created our VM, it got associated with an NSG, right? So for the before demonstration, I have removed it. I have disassociated the NSG. Let's go back and associate that network security group back to the network interface of this VM. So now our VM is associated with both NSGs again. Let it configure the NSG to the interface, and let's go back to our VM and look at the networking options where we can find effective security rules now. Here it is. So effective security rules is a way of displaying the rules associated with a specific resource. It's like consolidated information from both NSGs or whatever the NSG is associated to that VM or resource. In this case, we have two NSGs associated. They are represented here side by side. So you can actually look at the rules side by side and figure out which rules are causing problems. In the earlier screen, it was not possible to look at inbound outbound rules at the same time. We need to switch between inbound rules and outbound rules, but with effective security rules, you can actually consolidate all the information and compare both of the NSGs and figure out which rule is causing the problem. So this is how the effective security rules will help for us to figure out the issues related to the network security groups and their rules. So that's it, guys, for this video. I'll stop this discussion here. In the next video, I'll talk about routing tables. So please watch these videos in this sequence to understand the concept clearly. Also, please do subscribe if you haven't already to get notified when these new videos are getting uploaded. Thank you so much for watching this video, and have a good day.